He's chosen instead to go and spend the evening at EPSRC in Swindon. Well, bad luck him. So they've asked me to chair this, and it's a tremendous pleasure. Before I start doing any introductions, I've got some housekeeping rules to deal with. Firstly, could everybody ensure that their mobile phones are actually turned off? I tried to get away with putting mine on silent and was told off, because apparently it interferes with the pickup on the mic. So if you could put them off, that would be really good. Right, so having done that little bit of housekeeping, the Clifford Paterson Prize Lecture is a major event in the Society's calendar. It's given annually on any aspect of engineering in the broadest possible sense. And by engineering, this seems to have gone dead on me. Do you think it's gone dead on you? No, okay. So engineering in the widest possible sense. And this was initially endowed in 1975 by the General Electric Company. General Electric went through various transformations into Marconi and so on. It was endowed in 1975 in honor of Clifford Paterson, who was a fellow of this society. He actually was the creator of the GC Hearst Research Labs. He'd worked at NPL in Teddington, where he was a world expert in the measurement of the units of photometry. So there is a connection with very much with the subject of today's lecture. He was elected a fellow of the Royal Society in 1942. The lecture is given annually, and a gift of £500 accompanies it. Yep, still there. The Society has actually changed its strategy and now aims the lectureship at early and mid-career scientists. So some of the early and mid-career scientists who have been awarded it in the past include Cyril Hilsum, you're supposed to laugh at that point, Mike Brady, Wilson Sibbett, and many others, including some of our distinguished guests sitting in the front row that they've just told me about earlier today. Now, I need to introduce our speaker. Martin Plenio is a Royal Society Wolfson Merit Award holder and a professor of quantum physics at Imperial College, and he directs the Quantum Information Program at Imperial. I've known Martin ever since his PhD period. He was my postdoc, and then we were extremely lucky to appoint him to a faculty position. He was a PhD student in Göttingen in Germany, then came funded by the Humboldt Foundation through their Theodor Lunen Foundation fellowships to Imperial, was a lecturer in 1998, and he was the Maxwell Prize winner of the Institute of Physics in 2004. What Martin works on is quantum information. He's built up the group on quantum information theory at Imperial College into a world-class group. He's made important contributions to the theory of entanglement. And although he's a theoretician, he's worked very closely with experimentalists, some of whom are actually sitting in the audience, I note. And his theoretical efforts have stimulated experimental confirmation and further investigation of a whole wide range of areas involving the practical realization of quantum technology. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to present Martin Plenio to give this year's Clifford Paterson Lecture. Martin.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Peter, for the introduction. And also, of course, I have to thank the Royal Society for giving me the opportunity to speak here today. That's certainly it's a big honor, and it's a pleasure to be able to or be given the opportunity to try and explain to you why I find my research area actually an interesting and exciting thing to work on. And, you see the title, it's Taming the Quanta. And that's a little bit cryptic, maybe. And so some of you might have actually looked at the program, looked at the name, and said, well, okay, let's go to the web and find out what this guy is actually doing. So you may have typed my name, and you will have found quantum information as my work of subject area. And if you would have then Googled this a little bit more, and you would have found most likely quite a lot of mention of a particular aspect of quantum information science, actually, and that is an aspect that gains a lot of attention in the popular press, let's say, and that's the quantum computer. Now, this lecture is not going to be about this, actually. So, quantum computer, I don't want to sort of speak negatively about that. I mean, quantum computer is going to be eventually, I hope, realized, and it's going to be a device that will be composed of many, many atom-sized components that we will have to manipulate with an exquisite level of control. And that's going to be a very, very hard task. And it's sort of, certainly at the beginning, it formed sort of the holy grail of the field that we were all sort of aspiring to maybe. But really, what I want to show you in this lecture is that there is more to quantum information than just quantum computer. In fact, the path towards building such a device is really the interesting thing, in my view. And like in many other areas, if you choose a goal, it might be a grand goal, a very far-reaching goal. Maybe you will never achieve it, but the path towards this goal may give you a lot of interesting science that you can discover. And that's really what this lecture is going to be about, in a way. So, right, so that's quantum computing. That's how much I'm going to probably mention about it. Also, I mean, as Peter said already, I'm a theoretician. So you may perhaps be worried that I will now explain a whole lot of abstract concepts with plenty of formulae and lots of mathematics. Well, it won't happen. This talk has one formula, and that's a chemistry formula. Right, so let's get started. So I told you about the quantum computer. I told you about the path towards the quantum computer. Well, this path is really about learning how to deal with quantum mechanical systems. And why would we want to do this? Why is it necessary for us to try and deal with quantum mechanical systems, little atoms trying to control them? And now I want to step back a little bit and just look at technology and how it evolves over time. And so here we have some exponential growth laws in technology. So one will concern measurement precision, with measurement precision that we use, that we achieve for measuring space and time, for example. Communication capacity, for example, over in the internet. Computational power, energy efficiency, energy consumption. These are all sort of technologies or quantities that either grow exponentially in time or they decrease exponentially in time. So, well, measurement precision grows exponentially in time and energy efficiency grows. Well, actually, all of this grows exponentially in time. Sorry. And I would like to convince you a little bit that this is indeed the case and why this already is an exciting thing. And so have a look here. So this is a plot. Here we have time, that's years, so it ranges from 1940s to about 2010. And on the vertical axis, this is a logarithmic scale, you have units of uncertainty, that's nanoseconds per day. And this is basically a plot that tells you how precise clocks are and how their precision changes in time with technological development. So if you go here, let's say you go one step down here on this on the vertical axis, you actually decrease the uncertainty of the clock by a factor of 10. Okay, so a straight line here actually means that you have an exponential improvement or exponential decrease in the uncertainty of a clock. And so here are various clocks. They are all actually atomic clocks, and there are different makes of them. And you can see that this lies almost perfectly on a straight line. So, and then here are sort of watersheds like here, that where you have to introduce actually new technologies to keep this exponential improvement actually going. So, and you could ask, okay, well, what do I care about being able to measure time so precisely? So here, in the end, this is actually 10 to the minus 15. What this actually means is that we have about a precision of about 1 second in the lifetime of the universe. So you may ask, well, what's the point of that? What can this possibly be useful for? And so I give you just a brief illustration of that. So that's actually the first working atomic clock. At its time in 1955, it was the most precise clock in the world. It was built at the National Physical Laboratories here in the UK. And nowadays, they're a bit smaller, actually. So you can take these atomic clocks, you make them quite fairly small, and you stick them on a satellite. And you send that satellite up into space, and then it looks like that. Actually, do this with 34 satellites. And what you will get then is it's a GPS system. And what is this GPS system doing? Well, what it's doing is it allows you to buy these sort of things. Many of you will have them in their car. They tell you whether to turn left and right. And basically, they depend on the existence of this GPS system. And this, in turn, depends on the existence of very, very precise atomic clocks. In fact, what happens is that basically your device exchanges signals with those satellites. It measures how long they take, these signals. And in that way, it works out where on planet Earth you actually are. And to a pretty good precision, I mean, it's a meter or 2 meters or 3 meters, something like that. And it turns out that the atomic clocks that they have on those satellites, they have a certain uncertainty, and this puts a limitation on how precisely you can locate yourself in space, and that's an uncertainty of about a meter or two. So that also tells you that if we would have tried to build this device in the 1960s, there would have been no way. You would have driven it into all sorts of obstacles with your car. It would have been so imprecise that the system couldn't have worked. So it's really important that we drive the precision of atomic clocks, for example, further and further to be more precise in measuring time and therefore also space. So that's just one example why it is actually important to drive technology further and further. Here's another one that you may actually know a little bit better or have heard about before. That's called Moore's Law. And that's a question about computational power. So here the question is, the vertical axis is, again, one of those logarithmic axes. So if you go one step up, you increase your computational power by a factor of 100. What that means is the vertical axis tells you how many calculations per second you can perform on a $1,000 device. Right? So that's our unit. And then you can see, again, actually, this is not quite a straight line. It grows even faster than exponential. So it's a little bit faster than exponential. And here what you can see is different technologies that have played a role here. So at the beginning, well, that's sort of not, it's sort of a computer. It's a tide predictor by Kelvin. I took this from a science museum website. That's somewhere down here, actually. So very, very slow device for its $1,000. Now, here we go a bit further, and we have a device that works with electrical relays. And that's the SUSE Z3 computer. And it's essentially the first sort of programmable universal computer that was built, and it had a clock speed of 10 hertz. And that was electrical relays. Then we moved further, and that's the device that was built here in the UK, ETSAC, actually by Maurice Wilkes, who is with us here. And that is a device built with vacuum tubes, and that was the first computer with an internally stored program. And I don't know the clock speed of that one, but it was certainly faster. Now, when you go further, this is my favorite computer ever. That's my first computer that I bought when I was 15. Cost me my entire life saving. And really, it's a wonderful device. I still treasure it. It had a clock speed of 988 kilohertz, so just a notch under 1 megahertz. So it's already almost a million times faster than this one. And it has cost me then 800 Deutschmarks. Right, and then nowadays, the computers all look the same, really. They all look like that. And they are, however, another factor of 1,000 faster. They have clock speeds of about, well, 2-3 gigahertz normally, what you have on your desk now. So what you can see here is that this computer is a billion times faster than that one. This is amazing. And this was made possible through a progression of introducing various different technologies, so the electrical relay, the vacuum tube transistors, the integrated chip, and you introduce these new technologies, and this allowed you to push forward this exponential increase. If we would have been stuck with with tubes or so, there would have been no way that we would have had a gigahertz computer. You would not have a laptop nowadays, I mean, stuff like that. So it was really essential that we introduce, that they're always trying to push the boundaries, find new technologies to keep this growth going. So what does it mean? So here we make computers faster. What does this actually mean? So actually that means that we are making the components smaller. So you can see again time, again one of those logarithmic plots, and here's the transistors per chip, per unit area of chip. So this is again sort of the number of transistors is growing, the size is decreasing, and it's again an exponential decrease. And now if you sort of look and extrapolate this, not so distant, not so far in the future, in 2015 or so, you will really start to have atom-sized devices here. So obviously we are reaching some sort of boundary here. And the worry is that when you have such small devices, then what we call quantum fluctuations will play a role and will probably cause us problems. At least that was a worry. So we really have to think very hard now. What are we doing? What are we going to do at this boundary here? So it's going to hit us sooner or later, so we better start thinking now. Just like other people in the past might have started thinking about vacuum tubes before maybe the limit of the electrical relay was reached. So that's really motivation for trying to look at quantum technologies now. So here I would like to sum this up a little bit. So what you see here is a technological progress, so it drives engineering almost unavoidably towards the quantum regime. We're making our devices or the components smaller and smaller. Everything becomes smaller, and so quantum fluctuations will eventually become important. And one may view this as a threat and say, well, this quantum noise, this will actually disrupt our devices, and we will just not be able to carry on. So the question is what we can do. And this is really now where quantum information theory comes in, because it tries to take a different viewpoint. It tries to see whether these quantum mechanical properties that inevitably show up, and I will explain some of those to you in a moment, maybe we can use them to our advantage. Maybe we can see and try and see, say, well, okay, there might be some noise, but maybe there are also some useful features here that we can make use of to either improve our computational devices or just find new applications. And that's really an opportunity that we are trying to take here. So use quantum properties to our advantage. And the challenge, of course, is if we want to use quantum properties, we have to be able to manipulate quantum mechanical systems. We have to be able to prepare them, put them in place, measure them, manipulate them, all sorts of things. I mean, we really have to have control over these devices. And this is really what we are trying to achieve nowadays. Okay, and I hope I convinced you that this is a worthwhile sort of thing to at least try. Okay, so that's the motivation why we are going on about quantum information theory. Now, what are these quantum properties? So I would like to explain to you in very simple terms, no equations as promised, some crucial quantum mechanical properties. I will give you just to try to give you an idea of it. And then I will show you how we are using those, actually. Okay? So here, now I do experiments. Of course, I'm a theoretician, so these are sort of pictures of experiments that other people may have done, and I paraphrase them a little bit. So here we have a lamp. And so we make experiments with light. And here we have a device that is a detector that measures how much light is arriving in this place here. So this light is shining, and this is the detector, and this is what the detector sees. So it sees sort of basically almost constant stream of light. It sort of fluctuates a little bit maybe, but not very much. And then now let's do the following. Let's dim this light a little bit. And now what you see is, well, obviously, we make it dimmer, so the intensity is going down. And what you should also see is that some of the fluctuations start to rise a bit. And we make it dimmer, and the fluctuations rise even more. We make it even dimmer, and you start to see there are these sort of gaps appearing here. And you go even further, so much, really, to a very, very low intensity. And what you will see is that actually this detector will not just see a dimmer and dimmer sort of stream of light. It will see individual clicks. What it actually sees is It will click here, then it sees, then it claims at least it doesn't see any light, then it clicks again and it clicks again. And what this teaches us is actually that light, at least when we are trying to detect it, it reveals a particle character. It's composed of little packets of energy, and we call those photons, a quanta of light. And that is something that has been confirmed in many, many experiments. I mean, for example, I mean, G.J. Taylor, who was an extremely eminent experimental physicist, turn of the century, did experiments of that type. And this is really like that. So it seems really that light seems to be formed out of little components of packets of energy. And we realize this only when we make the light very, very dim, so that really these individual packets of light are flying into the detector. And so we see individual clicks. So that's fine as well. So let's explore this a little bit further. Let's do another experiment. So now I magnified these. These bars still indicate individual clicks. I just made them a bit higher so you can see them better. And now I want to see what happens if I take one of those photons and I let them fly onto a device that is called a beam splitter. So it's basically you could take a sheet of glass, for example, that will reflect a little bit of the light, and it lets a little bit of the light through. Just like, I mean, you know, when you look in the window and the light is shining on it, some goes through, some is reflected off. So let's see what happens. So we put a detector here, and we put a detector here, and we check now what will happen if we send these individual packets of light, these photons, onto this beam splitter. And so we will see clicks in this detector and clicks in that detector. And what we observe, and again, experiments very well confirm this, that it's either the upper detector giving a click or the lower detector giving a click. They never click both at the same time. Okay, so what this shows us is that these photons, they have to make a decision. They either bounce up or they bounce down. They're not split into two parts. And what will also is the case is if you analyze sort of this time sequence here, what you will find is it's completely random. There's no way for you to predict whether this detector clicks or that detector will click. The photon makes a completely random decision whether it goes this way or that way. Right, so what this shows is that quantum mechanics is inherently a random theory. I mean, there's some randomness that we cannot control. And this has been confirmed in many, many experiments time and again, so we have to accept it and we have a theoretical description for these things. It's a bit counterintuitive, but that's the way it is. So now I talked you really into this picture that light is made up of photons. So now I'm going to challenge that. I make another experiment. And, that came a bit too early, but it doesn't really matter. So here you have a beam splitter. Here you have another one of these beam splitters. And up here you have a mirror, so that reflects all the light. And down here you have a mirror. So we send again one of those photons in. So the light comes in here. So now I would say to you, well, we learned before that it makes a decision. Either it goes this way or it goes that way. And then the photon, let's say it goes this lower path, it comes to this beam splitter, makes another decision. Either it goes here or it goes there. That's what we would expect from this particle picture. And so, okay, so now we have to do the experiment, because in the end, I mean, expectation is one thing, but we have to ask nature what nature is telling us. And this is what nature is telling us. All the light arrives at this detector. No light whatsoever arrives up here. And that is a big surprise now that I talked you into this particle picture, because you cannot understand this with these particles. But what is happening here is that nature reveals another aspect of light. And that is something that you may have heard before, that light is made up of a wave. It's a wave phenomenon. And indeed, if you would do a very similar experiment with water waves, so you build channels here and then they split up and they combine again and you look whether there are waves here and here, what you would actually see is a very similar outcome. So you would have waves in some channel, they would amplify each other. In another channel, they would actually cancel each other out, because a wave that comes from here and that wave that comes from here may have a phase difference. And so when the one wave is at its peak, the other one might be at its minimum, and they cancel each other out. And you can do these experiments yourself at home or in a pool or something like that. And you can play a little bit and you can see all these wave phenomena that are actually also happening with light. And you can observe them because these water waves have much longer wavelengths, while the optical wavelengths, so light, has wavelengths of a few hundred nanometers, so that's too small for you to see. So what we see here is that we have wave phenomena and interference. So waves can cancel each other out or can amplify each other. And so then, now the last thing that I want to show you is what happens when you actually try and learn something about a quantum mechanical system. And that's something that we do all the time. When we do in science, when we do experiments, we go along, we prepare a system, we let it evolve somehow, and then we make a measurement on it. We want to learn something about it. So let's try this here. Let's try, for example, to try and see how far our particle picture carries. We would like to find out whether the photon really goes here or here. Somehow this cannot be true, but let's try and make a measurement and let's try find out, is the photon here or here? And so let's see what happens. So we put here a little gentleman who will actually make measurements on this light. It tries to find out, was there a photon or was there no photon? And he will do this maybe by attaching some magnifying glass, some apparatus. He might interact with this light. He might stop it. Or he might absorb it or something like that. What the crucial point is, it doesn't actually matter how he does it. No matter in which way he does these measurements, if he learns which path this photon has taken, both detectors will click. Or both have the chance of clicking. Sometimes this one will click, sometimes that one will click. And again, that's mind-boggling, but you can test this in experiments. And the really interesting point here is the following. If I would have put all this into a black box and we can't see it, and we just have access to these two detectors, then actually we can find out whether anybody is sitting in this black box and trying to find out which path the photon has taken. If nobody is in there, the photons propagate in peace, only the lower detector will click. If someone is messing about in there, trying to find out where the photon is going, trying to make measurements, both detectors are clicking. So this is really a noticeable difference, and it's a very important difference. And it's a very important fact that whenever you try and make a measurement on the quantum system to gain some information from it, you perturb it. And this perturbation, in one way or the other, can be detected by you. So that's important, and all these things, this sensitivity to noise, for example, or this sensitivity to someone trying to learn something about the quantum system, this is what we're going to put to work for us now. So just a brief summary again. So if you have freely evolving quantum systems, they behave sort of more or less like waves. We try to measure them, then they exhibit a particle character, and if we measure quantum systems and try to extract information, we necessarily perturb them in a way that we can detect. Okay, so this is the short course about quantum mechanics. If you have understood that, you have actually understood a lot about it already. Very important things. And what we at university then, of course, do is only put formulas around that. So now let's put these features to work. And I would like to show you two things. And first one that I want to talk to you about is secret communication. And that's a very important problem. Basically, since humanity existed, everybody has secrets. Sometimes you may have to communicate with someone else about your secrets without anybody else being able to learn about them. And so humanity, over time, has invented all sorts of ways of actually doing secret communication. So this is an old device, about 2,000 years old or so. It's a Skytale, I have no idea how to pronounce it. Basically how it works is you have a leather strap here, you wrap it around some piece of wood, and then you write your message on it. Then you take the leather strap off, give this to someone, he walks away, brings it to the receiver, and the receiver has exactly the same piece of wood, same diameter, you wrap it around, and you can read the message that was sent. If you have a different piece of wood here, one that is much thinner, you wrap it around, But then, of course, you will not be able to reconstruct the message. The letters will not recombine to the original message. And so what you need here is that sender and receiver have the same piece of wood in this case. And we, in modern language, we call this the key. Same principle, actually, here. This is an Enigma machine that was used in the 30s and 40s, also during the war. And it is basically a very clever way, or very, well, very clever way of taking a message and scrambling it up in a systematic way that is given by some little sort of cartwheels, well, whatever. These can turn and they tell you which letter you have to replace by which other letter. And so, of course, if you send them this scrambled up message, the receiver has to have the same device to be able to decode the message. So again, sender and receiver have to have the same device to be able to encode and decode the message in such a way that they can both read it. And nobody else should have this device, or this key. And here, this is what you're doing nowadays. You might have a mobile phone. Here's a credit card. You pay your parking fee in front of the Royal Society, for example, by telephone, which you can do now. And of course, you don't want anybody to find out what your credit card number is. So again, you have this problem that you have to somehow communicate with other people in a way that nobody else can decipher, only the sender and receiver. So, and in each case, here it's a little bit less obvious, but in each case, you have this property that you have to have sender and receiver have to have an encoding and decoding procedure, which we call the key, that is identical, and nobody else in the world has that. Okay, so, well, we write this in this actually almost qualifies as a formula, so that's half a formula. So nowadays, everything is computerized, so this key is just a sequence of numbers, and this sequence of numbers has to be identical at the sender side and the receiver side. It is ideally, it should be completely random, but in such a way that the third digit here is really the third, is equal to the third digit here, the fourth digit here is equal to the fourth digit here, and so on. So they have to be random so that we can use them to completely scramble up a message and it looks random to everybody in this room except to the receiver who knows how it has been scrambled up. So we somehow have to now establish this key. So how do we do this? Well, sender and receiver can, of course, come together, write down this key, copy it down, walk away, and communicate. But that's an extremely inefficient task because, really, you don't want to have to come together first to make a secret communication, right? So you want to be able to establish some key like this over a distance. How can you do this? How can you make sure that nobody else can sort of interfere with the establishment of this key? So how would you do this normally? Well, you would be far away, and we would exchange messages. Now, I exchange messages with you. I exchange sound waves with you, actually. So they go out of my mouth, well, from my brain to my mouth, to your ear, and there they are decoded. The problem with sound waves is they are really in the classical physics domain. All of you can listen in, and it doesn't really make a problem that Alvaro is sitting there listening to me. All of you can hear me. It's not really no perturbation, right? So an eavesdropper, a nasty person, can listen, and you don't even realize that this person is listening. So you can do the same with all sorts of other particles, physical particles, as long as they're big, chunky, classical particles. It's always the same problem. You send them around. Someone can make a measurement on them. You won't realize the perturbation. But I told you, quantum particles are different. If you send quantum particles around, individual photons, for example, and someone tries to measure them and extract information, it's unavoidable that you actually suffer some perturbation of that system, and you can detect it. So this is what I explained to you. When these people, sender and receiver, exchange classical messages, an eavesdropper can just listen in. He can see every signal that has been sent, and he can just establish exactly the same key as sender and receiver, and you won't know about it. In quantum mechanics, it's different. So when this eavesdropper is trying to make measurements, just like in this little interferometer, in this device where I sent these photons bouncing off mirrors and so on, I showed you, you make a measurement, you get a perturbation, it shows up in the detectors at the end. So what happens is that we can find out whether there is someone in the middle. If we send individual photons, we can find out whether there's an eavesdropper sitting in the middle by just observing the messages, the noise in the transmission line. So that's already a nice thing. This is something that you cannot do in classical physics. Only in quantum mechanics that's possible. You can find out whether there's an eavesdropper in the middle. That's not quite enough yet for really a useful scheme, because that only tells you, there is someone in the middle eavesdropping on our messages, so he knows our key, so we have to throw everything away and try again. So that would make really this transmission line completely useless. But the nice thing is that actually what is also true, and this can be made very rigorous, is that in quantum mechanics, when there's an eavesdropper and he tries to obtain a little bit of information, he causes a little bit of noise. If he tries to obtain a lot of information, he will cause a lot of noise. So by measuring the noise level at the receiver end, we can actually put bounds on how much the eavesdropper has actually learned about the transmissions. And so that is now extremely useful, because then we end up in a situation like this, possibly. We can quite possibly say that sender and receiver may have this and that amount of information, and the eavesdropper may have less. That's not yet good enough, because still we don't know exactly which parts of the key he knows. But now magic comes, actually classical computer science magic. There are methods by which you can actually make sort of systematically, the sender and receiver can publicly communicate, and they can effectively identify those parts of the key that the eavesdropper has attacked and has gained knowledge about. And you can repeat this procedure many times. The sender and receiver have to sacrifice some of the messages that they have received, but they can at the same time remove all of those that the eavesdropper has any knowledge about, and they arrive with some smaller set, which is completely secret. Now, this is something you have to believe. There's not, I mean, this is even, I don't really know exactly how these things work. But there are really wonderful procedures that achieve that. And, well, now to show you, actually, this is sort of quantum technology that is already nearly, well, almost in the marketplace. So you can do this sort of key exchange, secret messaging between different stations, for example, Geneva, under the Lake of Geneva to Lausanne, and then back by a Nyon. You can, in the future, we hope, and there's a big plan for this, to actually make this key exchange with satellites to establish a worldwide net of cryptography. And, well, if you really have deep, very deep pockets, you can actually buy some sort of devices that do quantum cryptography for you. Quite a lot more expensive than most desktop PCs, I can assure you. But it's still amazing that this quantum cryptography was conceived initially in 1984 by Bennett Brossard. Now you can buy it. It's quantum technology that you can buy. And it's really using a very crucial feature of quantum mechanics, namely fragility to noise. So now for another thing. Now I want to show you another aspect where we actually use noise to enhance certain processes, and actually quite important processes that you will see at the moment. I flipped the transparency a bit too quick. I mean, you see photosynthesis already. So I'm going to tell you a little bit how actually nature is going about using quantum features, or at least that's what we are starting to believe. And, well, what is going to happen here is that I told you that in cryptography we are trying to sort of make, well, an our worldwide network of quantum systems. But it's always sort of from station to station. Now what we want to do is, of course, as a quantum technology people, we want to have larger systems composed of several nodes, and we want to control them in various ways. And we want to see how we can use them for specific tasks. For example, energy transport. This is what this is going to be about. And really, well, initially you don't have so much intuition for that. But that's why it's good, actually, to look at nature and see what nature can teach us about this. And nature is using quantum effects in all sorts of places. So when I was looking up things for this lecture, I came across these wonderful articles where people now realized, scientists realized, that the reason why geckos can walk along the ceiling geckos can actually, they can hang on a single toe down from the ceiling and they're not going to fall. And really, the reason is sort of force, quantum mechanical forces between that originating from the vacuum. You don't need to understand that really, but really quantum mechanics explains why the gecko can stick at the ceiling. So it's really by looking at nature, we can sometimes actually discover wonderful quantum effects that nature has learned to use and we are now sort of discovering. Other examples are the analysis of where we can learn something from nature is the analysis of shark skin, for example, which when you look at the microstructure of shark skin and you replicate this, what you can actually use this for is you can, in principle, you can try and coat ships with that and they will have less drag and they keep cleaner. And so there are lots of wonderful features in nature that that nature has discovered for us, and we just have to find its ways. And this is what we are going to do now here. So I will just look a little bit what nature is up to, and then I will find an explanation for something that nature is actually doing since millions and millions of years already. Okay, so that's here, the tree. It has a leaf. The leaf is composed of cells, and the cells contain molecules, and these molecules have one particular purpose, and that is to absorb light from the sun and turn it into chemical energy, and in the end, let the tree grow and actually sustain all of us in the end. And so the molecule here is chlorophyll, and that's roughly its structure. Actually, cells are also doing that. So this is a green sulfur bacterium, and it also has molecules inside, very complicated molecules, and they're bacterial chlorophyll molecules. And the same task, these molecules. They have to absorb light and somehow transport this energy into some other parts of the molecule where it's then being used. So now I bring this down, and here the first formula. This is what the cell is doing. It takes carbon dioxide in the end, and water, you water your plants, and it takes the energy that comes from the sun into the molecule, somehow transported along here. It takes this energy, adds it to this, and then some complicated processes that I certainly don't understand, and what happens, take place, and what happens is that we get sugar or glucose, oxygen, and water again. And that's photosynthesis, and really we all depend on this. And I'm not going to be interested in that part because this is really very complicated. I will only be interested in the part from here to about here. How is the light, or the energy from the light, transported within this big molecule towards the place where the actual photosynthesis is taking place? And why am I asking this question? Because it turns out that this is an unbelievably efficient process. About 98% efficient or so. So very, very, very efficient. And we would like to understand how nature has managed to make this so efficient. And so now, as a theoretician, I have to abstract a little bit. So instead of having here all these complicated molecules, I just say I have individual sites that can support an excitation, which represents the energy that has been absorbed from the photon. So what will happen is light comes, it's absorbed here, and it creates an excitation here. It's actually an electron that is sort of jiggling around. And now what can happen is that you have actually that this excitation can sort of spread around, be transported in this molecule. It can explore all sorts of paths here. These neighboring sites allow for interchange of this energy, and even non-neighboring sites can interchange energy. And so this energy will spread out over this whole system. What will also happen is that occasionally this energy is going to be lost. So you have an excitation. This excitation can also be turned into light again and be emitted away. And that's a disaster for the cell because that's a loss. I mean, it's not going to be useful for photosynthesis in the end. So it's just absorption of light, re-emission of light. That's not interesting. And you want to avoid that this is happening, or the nature wants to avoid that this is happening. So now what you can do is you can take all these processes that you have seen so far, this re-emission of light, and all these interactions that describe how the excitations can wander around in this molecule, and you make theory now. So you can actually write down theoretical description of that. and you can work out how much energy, well, what probability, let's say, if one photon is emitted, what probability is there that this photon is really transported to the place where the photosynthesis is taking place. And you do this and you end up with some number about 60, 70%, far away from the 98% that nature is doing. So certainly there's something missing here. And clearly nature is cleverer than we are. So what is nature doing? Well, I told you actually that quantum particles are quite fragile to noise. So what happens here is you have these molecules, and they're actually quite big, relatively big molecules. So they can sort of bend and shake, and they're at room temperature, obviously, 300 Kelvin, so it's quite warm around. So there will be lots of vibrations and motion and so on. And what happens is that these vibrations and motions, they act just in the same way as this little person that is trying to find out something about the quantum state of the system. So you have these little these vibrations, they interact with your excitations here and perturb them, right? And so they introduce some extra noise, and we call this dephasing noise. And it just basically dephases and it tries to destroy a little bit this wave-like character of quantum mechanics. And now you would say, well, I mean, how can it possibly be useful to add noise? Well, I'll show you. If you add noise, just a little bit of this dephasing, then actually you will see that the probability for the energy absorbed from the photon to arrive at the at the center where the photosynthesis is taking place increases. You add more noise, more dephasing, it increases even more. Actually, it goes up to about 98-99%. You can optimize this and play all sorts of theory games. But really, what we are starting to understand now is that, or at least this strongly suggests, that really these molecules are optimized in such a way that they use this dephasing noise to enhance the transport of energy. So how can we possibly understand that this should really be the case? And for that, let's go back to the thing I started with when I explained you quantum mechanics. So here's again this interferometer, or this device, mirrors, beam splitters. And they're all fixed. So let's say these are fixed beam splitters, you cannot change them. You can only send photons in here. Your task is to make sure that some of them end up here. Well, there's not much you can do. You send the photons in, you know, I explained you, they all come down here. Of course, if you destroy a little bit this wave-like character, if you introduce some dephasing, if you introduce this little man here that tries to perturb the system, then some of the photons will come up here. So this noise can actually open up additional paths for transferring, in this case, photonic energy through a system. And so one way of trying to understand what this molecule is doing is exactly this. By having this noise and being properly adapted to it, this noise actually opens up additional paths for transporting the energy, and that allows for the energy to be transported faster before it decays back into light. And so almost all the energy is used back down there in the photosynthesis part. So again, in a quite surprising way perhaps, nature is using noise to enhance its performance. And of course you may dream whether this can allow you to understand solar cells a bit better or whether we can optimize them. And if we would get better solar cells, for example, then we may make these ones a little bit smaller here and so the satellite becomes a little bit lighter. That's a good thing. If you get more energy efficiency from solar cells, that obviously makes the electricity that we produce from them cheaper. So that's all something that is evidently useful. So I have no idea whether that's going to work. Maybe not, but it's still an interesting situation where we can see how we can use in a clever way an interplay between different quantum mechanical properties like noise and wave-like phenomena, and if they are tuned in the right way, we can actually get a better performance than just using one or the other. And so engineering question now is how can we create systems in a controlled way so that we have really this constructive interplay between all these processes. And that's what I find quite exciting about thing, I mean, about quantum technology. These are these rather novel ways of thinking about using technology and noise and quantum mechanical features, not really maybe to use them for a quantum computer, but maybe to use them for something quite different that may even be more beneficial in the long run. And so now I have to make a little bit of unashamed self-advertisement here. So that's basically almost the last transparency now. So what we are doing in our group, and it's a pleasure that so many of my collaborators have come here to listen to me and get bored because they know it all. These are sort of quantum technologies that we are exploring at the moment. So there are Bose-Einstein condensates of very, very cold atoms. There are not quite so cold atoms where we are working with people in Copenhagen. This is with Ed Heinz's group here at Imperial. These are very, very tiny cavities that trap light. These are the biomolecules that you have seen in the talk. These are trapped ions, which we have Richard Thompson and Danny Siegel that are here working on this at Imperial College. And we're also collaborating with Wolfgang Lange on this. And here is this is work with Oxford. This is photonic quantum information processing. And so a lot of our work actually is really about thinking about quantum technologies, talking to experimentalists, and hoping that maybe some of this may be useful for them. And here we really actually managed to end up writing a paper together with experimentalists. They did the experiment. We did a little bit of theory, and it worked out very nicely. But what I also should like to say is that it's very often the case that our work starts somewhere here. And this is really the abstract part of quantum information science, where we think about abstract quantum mechanical properties, we wonder about them, we learn about the structure of quantum mechanics, and then we come up with nice sort of discoveries, and we wonder, well, how can we test this? Where can this be useful for? And then this work from here may actually branch out into all these other parts. Sometimes it starts here, but often it actually goes in this direction. This is a good example. We did some very, very abstract work here. It ended up in some work with experimentalists now. And so this is a very nice feature of quantum information. You are fairly close to experiment. You can think about foundations of quantum mechanics, but they're not so far actually from real experiments. Right, and that's really pretty much it. So closing remarks. So I told you at the beginning, I mean, building a large-scale quantum computer would require us not to control only 3 or 4 or 5 particles. It will probably require us to control hundreds of quantum particles in an exquisite, unbelievable, I mean, really very difficult to do, let's say. But it's still a great goal to have because it sort of encourages us to build all these other technologies. And I'd like to quote here Michael Faraday, actually, who said basically, well, in the face of a rather difficult task, but still try for who knows what is possible. And I'd read this as, well, we should just try and see what happens on the way. And so what I believe is that there's lots of exciting physics to be discovered on the path, on the long, long path towards a possible quantum computer. And just in case there are some funding people in here, so in the 1850s, again, Michael Faraday presented some aspects of electricity. And William Gladstone, the then Chancellor of the Exchequer, supposedly asked him whether electricity had any practical value. And at the time, that was perhaps not clear, actually. This was actually very, very basic research, blue skies research, in a way. And, well, Michael Faraday did have an answer to that, and that is, one day, sir, you may tax it. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. We've got time for some questions from the audience. Now, we've got a couple of microphone carriers around on the left and in the middle. And so if you've got any questions to ask, wait for the microphone to come to you. And if you could then stand so we can see where it's coming from. And also, you've got to say your name at the beginning of the question. So I'm sure Martin is quite happy to answer any queries or questions you may have. So we've got one. First one there, and the second one, so we can identify it with the blue shirt there. Yeah, right.
Sharif, hello. Well, firstly, what a vision of Michael Faraday to have realized that potential with the taxing opportunity. Anyhow, thank you for that. I was just wondering, actually, whether the dephasing that you mentioned is actually arising in our brains, where the alternative neural pathways are being explored all the time. So that's just kind of one small point. And the second question was really, we often use the term random for things we don't know, but on that beam splitter example that you gave, I just wonder if one was able to look at the reaction that arises in the beam splitter in terms of the atomic vibrations or whatever, whether that would tell us a little about which pathway the photon uses without sort of causing too much dephasing. So I just welcome your thoughts
right.
on that.
Right. Well, for the second question, well, of course, there were over the, I mean, the sensitivity to this to noise or the fact that measurement introduced perturbation was at the beginning of quantum mechanics, I mean, people sort of doubted that. And there were many thought experiments that have been proposed, just like the one that you propose here, where people try to find clever schemes in which they try to extract some information without perturbing the system. And then when you really did either the theoretical analysis or, in fact, the experiment, you would always find the same answer. If you extract some information, you dephase the system. And there's a relationship, and then in the end, a mathematical relationship between those quantities. So if we assume that quantum mechanics is correct, which at the moment we do. I mean, it's well tested in experiments. If quantum mechanics is true, then we have to accept this feature. And so you can come up with nice experiments, and they will teach you a lot about quantum mechanics when you start to analyze them and find out why actually they don't work. You can learn a lot, but you will always arrive at the same answer. And as for the first question, that's very, very speculative, and I really find it difficult to... I think time may tell, but at the moment we have absolutely no suggestion that this is the case.
Okay, the next question is there.
Hi, my name is Mike. So your previous example with the measurement and the beam splitters and mm-hmm. stuff like that, everything that I've read about quantum physics, every time I've tried to understand it, I know the probability wave gets split into two, and then it interferes, and then it cancels itself out here and not over here. Mm-hmm. But then if you take a measurement here, the probability wave then collapses. What I've never really understood is what counts as a measurement? Like, under what conditions does the probability wave collapse? And I've never been able to get a straight answer from any of my professors.
I bet you don't today.
That's a tricky one. You see, the problem with that is you could sit down and say, okay, this is a classical device that makes this measurement, and we translate a quantum property into a classical reading of this device. And when this has happened, then the measurement has taken place. Now, the problem with that answer is that, of course, we know that quantum mechanics describes all of nature, so also this measurement apparatus. So it's difficult where we place the cut. So we could say, well, okay, we are special, we are different. So the cut is when we read off this device. But then you can say, well, we are also only part of nature. We are also quantum mechanical devices. So it's really a mystery, in fact, in quantum mechanics. So strictly speaking, the entire universe, you could think that it's described by a wave function and there is no measurement taking place. I would say it's a bit unsatisfactory. There are different interpretations, people trying to get their head around that, but I think I cannot give you a satisfactory answer because I don't know it.
Okay, thank you. All right, then right across here with the blue shirt at the front, and at the front, and then further back, yeah, as the next one after that.
Hello. Are there any analogies from photosynthesis molecules to, say, neurons, where you could find out if that particular neuron had knowledge of a particular thing? Could it be used for interrogation purposes to see if the human brain had knowledge of a given particular?
I can tell you, I mean, it's a little bit like the question that we had before. There's absolutely no evidence for that. And also, I have to tell you that a neuron is a fantastically large object compared to these photosynthetic complexes that I've been talking about. So it will take us a long time to explore questions like that. I cannot 100% rule it out, but there is no experimental evidence, I think, that speaks in favor of this at the moment.
Right. So the next one was, there we go. Wave your hands so the lady with the microphone can find you. There you go.
Hi. Which is going to be taxed first, a quantum computer or a 98% efficient solar panel?
Oh, that's... I can assure you that the tax revenues from a solar panel will be far larger. So, and it may happen earlier as well.
Okay. Do we have any other burning questions or issues? No. In which case, here's where we do the presentation of things. I'm really delighted to be able to present to Martin the Paterson Medal for 2008. There's the medal. It's still sealed up, so I've no guarantee what's inside, because I haven't acquired any information whatsoever, but I believe that's the check.
Thank you.
One of the things that you can see from this lecture is emerging technology. I've known Martin for many years, and I'm very pleased to see that for the first time ever, I've seen him use a Macintosh.
Against my will, I have to say. But it runs Windows, in addition.
Shame on it. Please, I think we've heard a most marvelous journey through some unexpected parts of the way that quantum physics can turn up answers to things that we may not have expected at all. Photosynthesis is one of the major processes in nature by which, for me, it's the reason why we're here. We've heard about quantum secret sharing. We've heard about some of the challenges in manipulating quantum systems at the most fundamental level. It's been a marvelous lecture. Please join me in thanking Martin Plenio for this year's Paterson Lecture. And that brings this evening's events to a close. Thank you very much.